When my tears turn to laughter, that child long ago, my soul starts to linger, it's home I know. If you catch me daydreaming, now and forever, thoughts are carrying.
The largest rail center east of Montreal. Moncton is often referred to as the hub of the Maritimes. As the second largest center in New Brunswick, the city's role today also takes in culture and communications, something inherited from its storied past, a past that at one point almost wasn't. When we look at it today, Moncton's history, like a metaphor, is played out against the daily tidal currents of the river that gave it its beginnings. This is the tale of a Renaissance city. This is the Greater Moncton region in New Brunswick. Visitors awaiting the daily phenomenon of the Petitcodiac. To locals, the waterway is the Chocolate River, and the coming and going of tides, the highest in the world, is part of everyday life. Charles Allaire.
The tidal bore is nothing more than a wave of water that comes in. If one can imagine the Bay of Fundy as starting off very, very wide and then narrowing as it comes into the Petitcodiac area, and by the time it reaches Moncton, it bottlenecks. So you have this vast amount of water that comes in with the tide and increases the water level to a certain degree so that it becomes a wave and washes across. There's been reports that the bore goes up to as high as 5 or 6 feet. Generally speaking, it's not quite that dramatic. And early settlers to this region, people who write of the bore, are fascinated both by the height of the wave and the roar that it creates all the way down the valley.
Also a part of day-to-day life, the arts, and biculturalism at work. Approximately one-third of the people who live here are Francophone. Mostly of Acadian descent, their ties to the region go back 3 centuries. Population 105,000. Greater Moncton is never far from its roots. When you live along the Petitcodiac, you reckon time of two kinds, sun time and tide time. The voices of the place, a blend of backgrounds and influences. Greater Moncton's makeup takes in the neighboring communities of Dieppe and Riverview, who share the riverbank with the city itself. Historically, communications and transportation are also part of the agenda. Its setting, near the head of the Bay of Fundy, along the Atlantic seaboard, places the region in a bigger world. Here, tracking aircraft out of Boston, New York, Paris,
is a part of the regular routine.
This is 7 November golf. Roger, request you check your front wheel side off and check my tango side.
Number 104, Roger.
Air traffic for 1 million square kilometers is controlled from a center along the Petacodiac.
8-5-7 November 2nd.
As ever present as the daily tidal bore, the railway. For over a century, it has been a dominant influence in the rhythm of life. Situated on the land bridge that links Atlantic Canada to continental North America, 500 to 600 cars move through here in a 24-hour period. Named after Lieutenant Colonel Robert Monckton, second in command to Wolfe at the Battle of the Plains of Abraham, the place's original name flowed from the river.
It's interesting that the Acadians use the river term Petacodiac or Petkodiak, which again was based on the Indian name. And while the Indians called it Petkodiak as bend like a bow, the Acadians would name this settlement Le Coude, again referring to this bend in the river, Le Coude being the elbow. And they used these wonderful dikes, which allowed for drainage of marshlands for freshwater, rainwater to drain the marshlands of salts and prepare the soil eventually for farming.
The Petacodiac is a link to the earliest French settlement of North America, Muriel Roy.
So all these places where the Acadians, the French colonists who came over and eventually called themselves Acadians, because the land resembled, because of the richness of the land, and it reminded them of the ancient Greek story about Arcadia, and so eventually the R dropped and it became Acadia.
Acadian culture, alive throughout Atlantic Canada today, is rooted in hardship. From its beginnings, the rivalry between France and Britain over the territory was to culminate in 1755 with the expulsion of the French, an event etched into the story of Canada.
Because they were taking over so much of the land and it wasn't encouraging for settlers from England to come over, so eventually it was decided to expel them, and on the pretext that they wouldn't take the oath of allegiance to the king. The population at the time was about 13,000. There were 600 who were put up on ships and sent down to the different colonies along the coast. And the others escaped. Some of them had already moved away because they had the feeling that this was coming about. Others, at the time when they started moving them out, they escaped into the woods and held out there until the Treaty of Paris in 1763, at which time they were allowed to come back.
The center for the county of Westmoreland, in the southeast corner of New Brunswick, Greater Moncton straddles the mixed fresh and salt waters of the Petacodiac. The river, running like a thread through its history, remains part of city life today. His backyard along the floodplain, Claude Roussel, a prominent New Brunswick artist of Acadian descent, interprets everyday occurrences.
There is a special life in the marsh. The interesting thing is to feel every day the pulse of nature. You know, you can see the high tide and the low tide, and the sun glittering on the wet clay, you know, the red wet clay. And I found out very quickly, I fell in love with the Pitcairniac because I really thought that the Pitcairniac was the greatest sculptor in Canada because it keeps modeling every day, and the shape it creates are ever changing, and it's almost like seeing the Rocky Mountains in miniature, if you wish. And maybe it's not as flashy as the Rocky Mountains, but I think it's as meaningful.
Twice daily, the waters of Fundy roll in, the river's fluctuation synonymous with Moncton's history. By 1766, joining surviving Acadians, families of Dutch-German origin arrived from Pennsylvania, attracted to the marshes. Lacoud became the Bend and was destined to evolve as a port of entry where traffic was scheduled with the tides.
The two groups eventually learned to live together, both of them having to face extremely hard, you know, harsh conditions because they're nonetheless in a pioneer settlement and both trying to rebuild lives for themselves. And beginning with the 1820s, we see the start of a small shipbuilding industry, which would eventually become the major economic force that would develop this area.
Arriving in 1846, Joseph Salter quickly rose to prominence as a shipbuilder and the Bend's first mayor. His influence was widespread.
Salter was a total abstainer, a teetotaler, and he was very concerned about the welfare of his men. The workforce marched on Salter and on the shipbuilders in Moncton, demanding shorter work hours. Literally, these people were working from sun up to sundown. So Salter was sympathetic to the men, but he was very concerned that the men would spend their extra time drinking and being to no good. So he provided them with a reading room and a place where they could go and educate themselves and spend their idle hours, hopefully becoming a little bit better citizens. The workers were very, very happy with this and actually paraded on a yearly basis to celebrate the shorter work day that Salter had given them.
Shipbuilding saw the settlement become a town. Over 60 ships, 20,000 tons of wooden vessels would sail down the Pitcairniac. But it was a short-lived heyday destined for Great Britain. Most were built on speculation, and then the markets plummeted.
Thanks to some bad dealings with some Liverpool merchants, Salter goes bankrupt in approximately 1856, and it makes it very, very difficult for him to build ships. He has to close down his shipyard, and it begins the economic decline of Moncton.
The failing of the Salter enterprise had a domino effect, triggering the collapse of the Westmoreland Bank of New Brunswick. By 1862, the community was in trouble and forced to surrender its charter. But as perennial as the tides, the town would rise again. The strength of the Fundy tidal currents, under study for hydro potential, keeps mud suspended in the river, reducing biological reproduction. It is the mud flats, rich in marine life, that are important as feeding grounds in late summer for the flocks of migrating birds. As the day progresses at Transport Canada's Area Control Center, controllers will monitor in peak periods flight patterns of up to 400 aircraft every 4 hours, a mix of 1,000 regional and international flights a day. Greater Moncton owes its present-day productivity to the era when the then colonies of New Brunswick and neighboring Nova Scotia made a move toward bringing Prince Edward Island into political union amalgamating three legislatures into one. The quiet event ultimately became the impetus for political union of the whole country. Ironically, it would be that union that would contribute to the rebuilding of the town following its earlier collapse.
By the early 1870s, an article in a St. John newspaper describes Moncton as a broken, tumble-down village, which in many ways it was. And probably at that point, the whole continued existence of Moncton would have probably been in question, whether or not it would ever become a successful community again. Interesting is that Confederation actually provides a second opportunity for Moncton. The Intercolonial Railway, the construction of the Intercolonial Railway, which was based as a Government of Canada activity, the national policy, which encouraged regional economic development, especially in the Maritime Provinces because of high tariffs and other parts of the policy, all tended to make the Maritimes an integral part of Canada's economy. So Moncton becomes very, very prosperous. It becomes a rail center.
The year before the Intercolonial Railway opened its shops, Moncton's estimated population was 1,000. By 1890, the community, now on the right track, had multiplied tenfold.
You can see the prosperity of Moncton by 1875 just in the fact that Moncton becomes a town again and adopts as its coat of arms a locomotive with the Latin term resurgo as a motto, or resurgo means I rise again. And the railway would keep Moncton a going concern right up until present day.
J'apporterai 10, I'll bring 10 and we'll decide between 8 and probably 8 or 9.
No, not enough time.
The arts in the region continue to thrive. The mix of languages, a part of everyday life. Once the geographic center of Acadia, today the community's role remains pivotal to the preservation of Acadian culture in New Brunswick. Greater Moncton today boasts the only Francophone Canadian university outside of the province of Quebec. It also has the distinction of being the only French law school training lawyers in English common law.
From 1963 on, the Acadians had their university, and that university has done so much for the Acadians because it has formed professionals in different fields, people who've gone on, a lot of them have moved out and attained fame and importance in their fields of activity, but a lot of them have stayed on here and helped to build the Acadian community in a very thriving, active group that is taking its place in New Brunswick society.
For Claude Roussel, New Brunswick means returning to his roots.
As a young boy in Edmonton, I was 7 or 8 years old, and I was carving things. And the thing that did make an effect on me was, richness of the forest, and there was big trees, and at one point I remember seeing a log, a pine tree on the ground, I had the urge to do something with it, and at one point when my father did catch a big trout, and he wanted to keep wanted to have a proof of size, I decided to carve him one. I knew that coming back to New Brunswick, the public taste is a little bit more traditional, let's say, as in central Canada. So that always had that in the back of my head, and I was always, you know, told I was too modern, and I know I did not please everybody all the time, but I did please some, a lot of persons who had the courage to look at things and question them and try to communicate with them.
Rising and falling in 12-hour cycles, the Chocolate River marks another day in history. Sun time and tide time. Maybe the reason people here take ups and downs in their stride. The Greater Moncton Area, a story of perseverance, preservation, of tides passing beneath Tidal Bore Park, and of a tribute to a Renaissance city and its people.
We can be ourselves, and it's fun to share it, and especially in the making of the Moncton 100 monument. Let's say I had never done any major works for the city itself. It was really a gelling of the minds and gelling of the ideas, and I felt at ease, and that's how those three very modern triangular shapes representing the sailboats associated with the figure of the first mayor of Moncton, who was a boat builder. And it's really a work that stemmed out of the community.